strap in, everybody, because this is probably going to be an elongated episode of Radiorama, whereas the name implies I'll show you how to work on radios and all other things that tend to run on glowing vacuum tubes. And today we have a 1960 Grundig Majestic S0191U1 stereo console. I believe that the Majestic name, that was an American company, and they would pair up with various manufacturers, either American, Japanese, or German manufacturers, and they'd slap their badge on it. It's a rather heavy unit. I already had a little bit of a casualty with this thing personally, because my wife helped me go pick it up, and then she had to go off to the grocery store or something like that, and I took it upon myself to unload it out of the truck by myself, which was a mistake, and I almost dropped it, and when I did, I caught it, and the corner of it nailed me in the lip, like busted my lip wide open. I was bleeding like crazy, and anyway, lesson learned. This came from a delightful family that I got to meet last week, and according to them, their uncle was stationed in Germany and bought several of these. There's several of these consoles in their house. They decided they didn't want that many. All the paperwork and everything is still here, along with all the accessories. I kind of have a feeling that the guy must have been a real audio enthusiast, because I found a bag of extra needles for the record player. Now, I was told that it was playing. They had this for sale, and there's one guy who I've been repairing a lot of German consoles for it, and there were some side speakers that this came with. He just wanted the side speakers. And they had a reasonable price on it, so he bought the whole thing and said, "Look, I don't have room for this gigantic stereo, so if you want me to donate this to the museum, I can do that." So we're like, sure, that sounds fantastic. I'm not going to plug it in because this cord is frayed, probably from being shoved up against a wall. That's not uncommon. But I am going to take the back off and hook up a cheater cord. I want to see what's going on inside. I've worked on large Grundigs like this before, and they tend to have several different chassis, and I think this is probably the same thing. So here we have the rectifier and output chassis, which has a quad of EL84s. That probably means push-pull audio. 6BQ5s if you're in the United States. ECC83s, those are your equivalents of 12AX7s. Here's the tuner chassis. And some of these had a reverb chassis. I'm not sure if this has that. This says radio chassis from Euro, so I don't think that has that function. So I'm going to take the back off. We're going to take a look inside and see what's going on, and then we're going to bring it up on the Variac. The other thing I'm happy about is that they made one model up from this that was a little bit bigger, and it came with round speakers. And those are not good, because what they did was they used a very early, very thin foam rubber for the surrounds, and that stuff solidifies, and unfortunately, they're a strange round speaker. They're like 11 inches or something. You can't buy replacement foam rings. You can try to make your own, but usually it doesn't work out. This has oval speakers. They're not 6x9s. They're also something weird. They're something like 11 by, I don't know. They're strange. Again, off standard size, and not uncommon for these German sets. It does have a reel-to-reel tape player. I've not had good luck with these. They tend to have a really problematic pot metal deck, which warps and cracks, and hence they don't really work that well. I'm hoping that since this has been a California set all its life, that maybe, just maybe, maybe the pot metal's not warped or cracked, but we'll see. I won't know until I take the stamped steel cover off. It's not crucial that it works. The people that are going to get this probably are not going to listen to reel-to-reel tapes. They're probably going to listen to records, or they're going to listen to a Bluetooth that will be connected to the back via the tape player connection. And so that's fine. It'll still, if I can't get it to work, it'll still be retained in there for the sake of original appearance. Well, the bummer is that the light bulb that was in here is missing. And it is a uncommon to the U.S. base, if I remember correctly. It's not a C9 or a C7 or anything like that. It's something different. I'm assuming that adapter should work. The record player is sort of sitting here loosely. I noticed there was a screw here. It's bent. And let's see, the keeper for the arm is still there. It has a little brush that cleans the needle every time you put it back in. That seems to be turning well. Hopefully the rubber friction wheel is still good. So let's take this back off and see what's going on. We'll at least see the tuner unit. Okay, well, here is the back removed. And unlike the other models I've worked on of this type, the power and amplifier chassis and the tuner are together in the same space, which is nice, because usually the bigger model has that unit down here on the bottom and it's hard to get at. And one of the first things I noticed is that all of the output tubes have RCAs, which is obviously it's an American tube, and so those are not the original. And I wonder if maybe the previous owner decided they wanted to have a fresh new set, which would make sense, have a fresh new matching set of tubes. It does have a fuse on it, which is I like to see. If there's anything really, really wrong, that will go first. So what I'm going to do is I have my combination isolation variac over here. I'll go ahead and put it on FM. Turn the volume down. Looks like the balance control is frozen. That's not unusual on these guys. It has one of these EM84 I tubes. Those are usually susceptible to going bad pretty quickly. So let's just put it on maybe, I don't know, 50% or thereabouts. Well, let's put it on 50% as far as volts go. And then I'm going to put it on amp. I want to see what it's drawing. Okay, it's not drawing much. That's a good sign. Let me see if there's any pilot lights happening. I'm not seeing any, but that could just mean they're burned out. All right, let's make sure it's turned on. It is turned on. Let me bring this up a little bit more. It's only about 50%. It is drawing something, so it's definitely on. Let me go back and take a look here. I really wish that... Oh, wait, here we go. I see a pilot light. I know it's hard to see. Looks like the ferrite rod antenna indicator is also lit. And the tubes are too dusty to see. Again, I'm just bringing it up slowly. Last thing you want to do is cause damage and destruction. The fact that it's not really drawing much makes me... See, I don't think there's anything horrifically wrong with it. Go ahead and bring it to 100 volts. That should at least get something. Of course, the controls are all dirty. Okay, let's bring it up. Yeah, these controls are filthy. So I'm not surprised I'm not really picking up anything per se. All right, let's go ahead and go all the way and see what we got. I-tube is completely dead. Well, what I'm going to do is, let me see what's going on with the tubes back here. Everything's running pretty cool so far. This is the FM-related tube. By the way, don't do what I'm doing. You should not stick your hands into electronics like that. I think actually maybe my loop antenna is not connected, so let me try to connect that. Okay, radio does not work. Audio obviously is working. Could be any number of different things. Could be something as simple as a bad contact. It could be a bad tube. I'm trying to think through the circuit design what would be the most appropriate tube if AM and FM don't work. It's probably... Let me take a look at the tube. Complement in this thing. Could be the ECH81 tube or one of those EF89 tubes. Those are the IF tubes. EM34 is dead. Okay, so what I wanted to do is start doing the painful process of taking everything out of this cabinet. And I'm going to start with the power chassis / amplifier chassis and then take the tuner chassis out. And the way that you remove the tuner is there's bolts on either side and then there's a retainer screw. I'll have to swing this out a little bit so you can see what I'm talking about. And it's wise to mark everything because sometimes these are not obvious as far as how it's put together. And be careful because there's a lot of fragile things in here that you can break very easily. All right, I've extradited both chassis. And again, what you want to do is make sure and just pay attention, mark everything. I mark all my plugs. And what I also do is these consoles have 10,000 different sizes of hardware. So what I tend to do is when I remove things, I'll just put the hardware back in its place. So when it comes time to reassembly, I'm not going to have to worry about what goes where or what piece I lost or whatever. I am disappointed because I thought this had oval speakers in it for some reason. And it doesn't. It has these god-awful speakers that almost always have very delicate foam rubber surrounds, and they're probably bad. There's literally no way to fix those. So what I tend to do is put in a pair of 10-inch speakers. These are 11s. 10s will fit just fine. The wood is sufficiently thick in the particle board in the front. I will overhaul it and see just for some shits and giggles miracle chance that they're still good. I doubt it. But I'm not worried about that right now. I have got both chassis out. Here is the power and amplifier chassis. And already right away, that tube looks like it's gone gassy or gone to air. I'm going to bet that tube is not good. We'll test it later. That doesn't explain why we weren't picking up any radio. If radio had worked, at least it would have heard something. Let's see. Let's take a look underneath and see what's going on here. What am I up against here? Well, it is indeed going to be a drawn out process because this is an earlier set as far as the German sets I work on, and it is absolutely crammed full of paper caps. When you see these guys, they have kind of the chalky looking ends. Those are paper film caps, and they go just as bad as their American brethren. These guys too, these little brown things, I call them like German deer turd caps. See, there's American ones too. There's like a RCA deer turd caps. These are just as bad, and sometimes it's hard to read the writing on them. This says 0.022. So how many do we have here? What am I looking at? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19. So there's 19 alone just in the tuner chassis. Let's take a look at the amp and power chassis. There's probably not going to be as many capacitors here. Nope. And it has been worked on, actually. That yellow guy down there, that is a Sprague. And then we've got this resistor here, too. That's not original either. 1,000 ohms, 10 watts. And then we have an orange drop capacitor here. So the chassis has been removed at some point during its life. And we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 paper caps in this chassis. And then we also have 2 electrolytic capacitors. Actually, I take that back. We have 4. There's 2 100 microfarad caps inside of each one of these cans. There's one on each side. I don't have 100 microfarad caps, so I'm going to have to combine 250 microfarad caps to get that number. We also have what appears to be a bunch of possibly low-value electrolytic capacitors. What are these? Why does it not say? All right, 25 microfarads, 12 volts. That's probably just like bias capacitors. Doing a little bit of extra filtering here. So definitely have the work cut out for me for sure. My brother's going to be over here in just a few minutes. I think what I'm going to do, just because I can't do much more tonight, is I'm going to at least test the tubes in the tuner section. I want to test that gassy-looking RCA tube as well. Well, first of all, we've got a very unhappy EF89 here. When I test it, it's suffering internal shorts. Had a few sparklers there. Now, maybe that could be that some cathode material had shedded a little bit. Yeah, it's not testing happy at all. Alright, so that tube is probably not good. Let me test it one more time. Maybe the pins were dirty. Yeah, it's rising and falling. That doesn't even come close to half of the bare minimum requirements out of that tube. So this tube is bad. I need to replace that guy. Okay, so I did a test on all the tubes in the tuner unit, and I suspect probably the set has had a lot of usage, like lots and lots of hours, because both of the ECC83s, which are basically 12AX7s, they were not even meeting the minimum requirement. Of course, the EF89 tube, this is bad. This one is okay. ECC85, which is most responsible for FM, is barely registering anything. ECH81 was okay. EM84, the I-tube, is obviously not okay. It's not even showing a phosphor. And so what we have here is just a really tired radio. There's nothing wrong with that. It's perfectly okay. If someone loved and used it for years and years and years, it's not unusual for the tubes to start losing their emissions. And so they just need to be replaced with fresher tubes. Now I'm going to move over to the amp and power chassis. I especially want to measure that one gassy looking tube, that one RCA 6BQ5 output tube. All right, so that gassy tube definitely tests bad. It's shorting on all sections except one. That's really bad. So that tube is screwed. I kind of figured. I mean, when you see a gas envelope, when you see like this white haze here, that means it's partially gone to air. I'm amazed it still has filament. You'd have thought that would have burned out by now. Man, like all the output tubes are hosed in this thing. They're all either shorted or not registering anything. So, again, I think like this was probably a set that was used a lot. And just basically, it's tired. So I think tomorrow I'll need to go do a little laundry shopping list over at the museum to get some extra tubes. And I'll go from there. This is going to be an interesting project. From the speakers, to the chassis, to the tubes, to the cabinet. All those good things. That's why I knew when I started this thing, it's going to be an epic project. All right, well, I'm over at the museum. Need to get some tubes. Let's see. Need an EF89. Sure hope we have... Oh, whoa, whoa. Wow, we have a ton of these. Okay, there's an EF89, and likewise, I need some 12EX7s and some EL84s. Stock up on these guys. Oh, yeah, I need an ECC85 as well. Hope we have that. Yeah, we should. All right, I went on a little bit of a, as you saw, a little bit of a shopping spree over at the museum. I don't have access to the drawer that is locked that keeps our eye tubes in it. We prefer to keep our valuable stock locked up. We only have two people have a key to it. But I did get some replacement tubes. This says Sovtek, but what's in this is Philips. So they're not Russian tubes. These are Gold Lion. Of course, obviously we can't get those anymore for good reason, because Vladimir Putin is a piece of shit and is violently attacking a country for no good reason. So he can burn in hell as far as I'm concerned. But anyway, that's beyond the point. So now I have the ability to repopulate all the areas that had worn out tubes. And before I get too carried away, I am going to start doing the recap job. I'll start with the amplifier and power chassis, and then proceed to work on the tuner chassis. We'll also need to clean all the contacts, because as heard while we were trying to power it up, while I was trying to power it up, clearly there's a lot of dirt in the contacts. It's very easy for that to happen on these guys. The other thing I'm going to do today before the end of the day is take one of the speakers out and cross my fingers and hope to God that by some miracle it's not the rotten foam surrounds, even though I pretty much am sure, I'm almost certain it is, because they look exactly like the same style, and I've seen them enough to know. One of the members says he could possibly help me refoam it. I'm not good at it. Last time I tried it, I just failed spectacularly, and haven't tried since, so maybe I'll try again. I don't know. We have a bunch of these speakers that are sitting at the museum, because I don't want to throw them away, because maybe someday we'll be able to fix them all. But if worse comes down to worse, I'll just buy a 10-inch replacement woofer, and that'll be totally fine. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is overhaul this chassis, and that is going to consist of replacing the two surface-mounted electrolytic capacitors, as well as Something funny is happening here. They have put these electrolytics together. Those two positives are together. So that must mean that actually it's not 100 microfarads. It's 200 microfarads. But why, if this is a stereo unit, why would you have the other side have two separate 100 microfarad capacitors? I mean, clearly that's factory, so I will need to observe that. But that means that combining these capacitors is going to be all kinds of fun. What I thought I was going to do is just have basically two electrolytic capacitors stuck together, 250 microfarad capacitors stuck together for each side. But in that case, here it's going to be four stuck together, unless I happen to have a 100 microfarad cap in my weird capacitor collection up here. I'll have to dig. See, I think maybe this is it. Let me look. Yeah, it is 100 microfarads. No, it's fuck. I need 200 microfarads. Keep on forgetting that. Let's see, Mallory, 150 microfarads. Well, I think what I'm gonna have to do is get creative here and get some terminal strips or find a creative way to install these guys. Yeah, these are not fun to work on. I can see why some people are flustered by them. I mean, I'm just used to working on them. I'm used to them being a pain, so whatever. Okay, so I know it's not the prettiest thing, but it's completely functional. What I do is I put two of these electrolytic capacitors together, and I cut their negative lead as short as possible so I can mount it to the chassis. There's no, like, moving around or wiggling or anything like that. This one's going to be a challenge. It's going to be basically four capacitors stuck together to form 200 microfarads. And I think what I'll do is maybe the same thing. I'll probably put two bunches of these together and then just run a jumper wire between them. And that will get my microfarad rating that I want. Because remember, we're putting a whole bunch of 50 microfarad caps together. So 200 means four. I'm looking at some of this and there's like some weird black stuff on these contacts. Not sure if that's carbon tracking or what. Or maybe it's a film they sprayed on the factory that's deteriorated. Looks like these both have a bias adjustment here. I'm not going to touch those. But yeah, I'm going to replace this last single electrolytic and then work my way down. It appears someone was in here and replaced this, which is gross overkill. 10 watts, 1,000 ohms versus the original, which is probably like half a watt, 1 watt. This electrolytic is already spewing entered, so it's probably shorted. Probably very low voltage on that. These are all 50 microfarads at 12 volts. What a very strange voltage rating. You couldn't just make it 10 or 20? Nope, 12. Very odd. I'm going to check these wire round resistors too. I find that this style, for some reason, these ends here, they corrode and sometimes that can cause them to go open. Some of these are not going to be easy to get at. They're underneath a bunch of crap. These things were probably built in layers. They would install parts, and they'd install parts over the parts. And that's why a lot of people really do not like working on German sets, because they're built not as easily to be serviced, which is annoying. But whatever. They can be repaired. You just got to take your time. Okay, so yes, I know it's not super pretty, but it's completely functional. We have tied four of these together to get our 200 microfarad rating. And now it's time to move onwards. I'm going to replace these electrolytics, especially that guy, and then lastly all the paper caps, which are going to, again, be real fun to get at. Okay, So the amplifier chassis is now overhauled. It wasn't that bad. It took me maybe an hour to do this. The more you do stuff like this, the quicker you get. This would have taken me probably all night, probably 15 years ago. But it is now time to move over to the tuner chassis. All right, so the amplifier is done, and I decided to get the painful part over with. I took one of the speakers out. Yep, it's got that crappy, awful foam. So right now, the cone is just not attached to anything. It's just free-floating. So either I'm going to have to repair this or find replacements. I'm aiming more towards replacements. Even though one of the members, one of our newer members, Kyle, is like, I can fix it. All right, Kyle, I'm going to bring it in tomorrow, see what you can do. All right, well, it's time to start working on the second chassis, which is the tuner chassis. And I took one look at it yesterday and thought to myself, that does not look fun. And so I suspect my attitude will not change when I flip this over. I remember there's something close to 20 capacitors in here that need to be replaced. They're all paper caps, and the caps that came out of the amp and power chassis looked awful. There was a lot of them that had melted open. And so I suspect there'll be some equally nasty caps in here. They all need to be replaced. So I'm going to flip it over. You got to be careful with these guys, because if you flip it over, let me rest it on that, because this, I believe, comes up. No, not necessarily. Probably what I can do is put something here when I turn it upside down, like a can or something, so this doesn't touch. All right, well, here we go. Here goes nothing. I'm just going to start replacing capacitors, and what I tend to do is snip one end of the old capacitor off, especially if you can't see the value, you might need to twist it around. And then I'll attach one end of the new capacitor, which is this guy, and then snip the other side and repeat. Just do the whole thing. I do that because I don't want to lose my place. It's very easy to suddenly not pay attention, and then you're out of shit. You're up a shit creek without a paddle. Sorry, I've had a lot of people lately say, you curse too much in your videos, and I'm not doing a good job of trying to oblige by that, so I'm sorry for all the people that are offended. Well, I decided this is all I want to do for the evening. I feel like whenever I start getting to a point where, I don't know, like I feel like I want to rush on something, or I don't feel like working on something, that's time to quit. It's time to throw in the towel for the night, because then you're not going to do as good a work when you are either impatient, or you are tired, or you're bored. You need to make sure and put your whole self into these projects. Otherwise, you'll make a lot of mistakes. And on something like this, making a mistake, it's a lot more harder to track down that mistake versus something like, I don't know, 5-tube American set where it's like, oh, there's like 10 parts in there. This has like 10,000 billion parts inside. So I want to make sure I'm doing it right. So that's it for this evening. Tomorrow we will pick it up again. All right, so all the capacitors have been replaced. I have to admit that was not very fun, but it's done. And I also cleaned all the contacts with the oxit. And now what I need to do is get this controls, the balance control, to actually start moving again. These guys, what happens is that the grease they used solidifies, and then you got to heat it up pretty hot to get that boiled out. So I use a plumbing torch on low. I'm just going to heat this little area here. Don't get anywhere the plastic or anything that'll melt. Luckily, the tuning cords are all steel on this guy. Okay, now that the tuner and the amplifier chassis are overhauled, I'm going to work on the record player and the tape player. Everything on this seems to be pretty gummed up. And I'm not even sure if I have any reel-to-reel tapes here. I might need to go over and get some. But how does it come out? I think I can get it out by opening the front door. Oh, how nice. It's held in by little thumb plastic wing nut things. So I guess when I loosen that, it probably just pulls out of the top. All right, stop recording. Stop. Okay, so I'm
wrangled this thing out of the cabinet. It was very, very tight. I had to remove the top. And it has the awful aforementioned pot metal deck. But I don't see any cracking or warping. So there's a chance this one actually might be okay. We've got a snapped drive belt. And I'm not a tape player person, so I'm probably going to get these terms wrong. But the cap span is kind of frozen. It needs to be loosened up. Looks like the drive motor's okay. Looks like the rubber's actually okay. This mechanism here, on the last one I worked on, the area underneath it was warped, and this is critical for driving, you know, the uptakes. And so I had to do some monkeying around to get it to work right. It looks like we're going to have to definitely clean the heads. But what I'm going to need to do is get to that belt. And I have some belt material that I could use. I think what I'll do is I'll measure this. I want to see, is it square? Yes, it's square. And I'll have to cut. I've got some generic belt material. That should be okay. And you can use super glue to put it together. I'll explain that in a little bit. This may be a failure. Again, it's the tape player in this is just kind of a nice to have because it's not exactly a nice tape deck. You know, if you were today's like snobby like audiophile, you probably would not want to use this. All right, it's been a while since I've worked on one of these. I think these come off. You got to pull these snap rings, and then there's something underneath. But I need to be able to get to that belt. Okay, so I was able to remove that one. Where do you call it? One of those wheel things. Anyway, got to be very careful with these things. There's some almost unobtainium-type parts in this thing. And... crap, did I already lose something? Oh man. That was like a little bitty C clip that I removed. There it is. Stay. All right, so what I've done, here's the old belt, and here is the replacement belt material. It's a little thicker, that's all right. And what you want to do is measure exactly that same length. Then I'm going to wrap it around these surfaces and then use a little drop of super glue. I know that sounds like that wouldn't work, but it does. Trust me. Need to come in here and clean up some shit too. It's pretty dirty. Okay, so I have installed the belt and here's the little seam. I don't want to turn this on for a while. I want that glue to completely cure because it's going to be under a lot of pressure. So I think I'm going to sit this out in the sun so the warm sun can kind of help cure it faster. And then I'm going to clean, what I want to do before that is actually get some Q-tips and some alcohol and clean these tape heads. I've also lubricated everything, including the cap span, how do you say that? Cap span bearings, see how that needs to be moving really freely. And now it is. What I did is I used some Zoom spout oil and I heated it up with a hairdryer to make sure it got down into the bearings and loosened that up a little bit. So I'm going to clean the tape heads and also probably need to clean the volume pot here and clean this guy, whatever this is. Some little switch thingamabob. I'm not sure what that's called. And again, set it out in the sun, let it cure. Such strange material. Okay, now we're waiting for the tape player to cure. It's time to take the record player out. And these are a little tricky. I'm glad I've worked on one of these before because the first time I tried to take it out of the cabinet, I was really confused. What you have to do is this part snaps on. And then what you need to do is come in and loosen these two guys. I think there's maybe a third one over here. Let me see. It's been a little while since I've worked on this, but I think this also has to come loose. or something. It's annoying because what they've done here is you have to lift it out through the top. You can tell it was installed via the top because you've got this back here with the screws painted over. So it's not like you're supposed to take the back off to get this out of here. The only way to get it out is by removing these little C-clips. And make sure when you loosen these guys to keep your hand over it, otherwise they'll come flying out of there and you'll lose them forever. And if it's like my garage, things just disappear. Luckily the rubber friction wheel is good and supple. You want it to be kind of sticky because what it's going to do is drive the turntable platter, which is really loose. So let's get these C-clips off. Hopefully there's not a third. What is this supposed to do? Oh, I see. These are keepers. So when you're transporting it, you're supposed to pull these up to keep it from bouncing around. I didn't know that. I've never seen these before. Okay, so we got the record player removed from the cabinet. And what I'm going to do is pull this flywheel off, pull this friction wheel off, and clean and lubricate everything. The reason I removed the rubber friction wheel is because, as one of my friends correctly pointed out, if you get oil on that, you'll ruin it. Like, it's very difficult to remove oil from rubber. It'll just slip. And these things are not cheap. If I were to order one of these from Voicy Music, we're looking at probably $30. And that's usually with a return, because what they do is they remanufacture these parts in Michigan. So it's worth the money. I mean, don't get me wrong. I love Voicy Music as far as the advice and the parts they've supplied me over the years. But if I can't help it, if I don't have to buy a new part, I'd rather not. Pretty nice record player, definitely. It's like a billet aluminum. The nice thick squishy mat. We can take all this apart and clean it, but what I need to do is take the C-clip off. And again, kind of keep your hand over it when you do it, otherwise I've had them fly across the garage and like I never see them again. There's probably like 50 of them in this garage right now because I've done that so many times. Okay, what we want to do now is come in and just basically oil anything that moves. I'm using a Zoom spout oil. I don't know what kind of quote-unquote oil it's made out of, but it works really well. It's more of a refined product versus like 3-in-1 oil, which, you know, there's nothing wrong with 3-in-1 oil. I've used it all the time myself. But again, one of our newer members, Kyle, he kind of shared this little tidbit with us, and it really does work a lot better. You don't want to oil anything too much. Just get a little bit in there because it'll work its way in. Let's see. I'm less familiar with this record player. Most record players I work on are Voice of Music machines. Voice of Music basically patented a changer that everybody used. Everybody. Because it was such a simple and yet reliable design. It looks like that my motor mounts have disintegrated. I'm trying to replace those. Usually what I do is I replace those with bib washers, you know, that you use in plumbing. And that's totally fine. So let's turn it back upright and lubricate the stuff on top. Oh yeah, I also want to lubricate the motor, even though it seems like it's turning pretty well. Let's see, it's even got a little cooling fan for the motor. How cute. All right, well, the motor mounts, the rubber motor mounts were completely rotten, like non-existent. This is one of the old ones. And so what I did is I got out my box of rubber grommets, and I'm just going to place the grommets inside of these guys, and that should give it sufficient ability to stay in place and still have some cushioning. You don't want to put rock hard rubber in there. It needs to be a little more supple. Okay, so we got the new motor mounts installed. Looks like I need to resolder this ground here. But then we'll set it upright and see what it does. We'll start reassembling the record player, make sure it all comes together and plays properly. It's all back together again. It seems like it's going real nicely. Let's see. Let's put the needle on. course, I have this not going through any amplifier, but I can. Seems like it's playing the right speed. That's good. All right, so the record player is probably mostly done. Let me reassemble that. And I think since I've done most of what I can do electrically and mechanically, it's time to start working on the actual case. See if I can drag it outside, get up my buffer. Well, I thought I was going to try to drag it outside, but even with all the guts out of it, it's heavy. What I'm going to do first is just go over the interior parts and bits with a little bit of cleaner, basically some mild detergent and some warm water. And then what I'm going to do is I think I'm going to clear these chairs out of here and face it towards the sun so I see what I'm doing. Meanwhile, the tape player is still sitting out there happily marinating away in the sun. It's a redundant statement. But anyway, I'm going to, again, clean out the interior and innards and stuff, and then swing it around. And we'll go over it with a series of furniture products that I will explain. All right, it's time to go over the cabinet. Man, this thing's got a beautiful finish on it. What I'm going to do is, it's got a slight amount of discoloration on the top here, probably from, I'm guessing, sun exposure. It's essentially, it's a plastic finish. I'm not sure if this is going to do any good. But what I want to do is even things out a little bit. I'm going to go over the whole thing with Old English. And no, it is not the Old English that comes in the disgusting malt liquor bottles at the local gas station. It's a furniture product. It's been around for forever. And yeah, I feel like all I'm doing is just smearing this shit on there. But it'll make sure and get and cover up whatever little microscopic scratches and abrasions this has. Especially this lower area, which has less finish on it, per se. Yeah, this thing's going to be beautiful when it's done. It's too bad I don't have an excuse, really, to have this for my own. I already have a lot of stereo consoles in my house, including a very large RCA. And, it's got 15-inch speakers in it, so this would never compete with that. And I'm all about big sound. Yeah, we're doing a lot of detailing here. See how that just kind of like brightens things up a little bit. So now, the next part of this process is going to be buffing the finish out. And because, as I said, this is kind of like a more of a plastic finish. It's a urethane finish. I'm going to use a plastic polish. And what that will do is that'll remove scratches and abrasions and scuffs. Because this should look like a mirror when it's done. And what I use is this handy dandy little attachment for my drill. Because I used to do this by hand, that it just absolutely killed my joints. And as I approach my middle-aged man years, it's better to like take it easy on the old joints. All right, so now it is time to start using, I use Novus number 2 plastic polish. A lot of the people in the pinball hobby use it for polishing plastic. I use it for everything. So it kind of looks like baby poop, but it does a great job. We're just going to do this number over the whole thing. It's going to take probably the rest of the afternoon to do this because there's just a lot of surface to go over. I want this thing to look like insanely good because we're probably going to ask a premium for it since it'll look spectacular. The other thing I wanted to mention is, so I already went ahead and ordered new woofers. That's what I typically do with these guys because trying to repair the originals, I've not had good luck with it. So I ordered some nice new 10-inch woofers. Last time I did that, it sounded really good, probably better than the originals. It's a shame I didn't use the originals, but again, I want this thing to have a very nice tonal quality. It needs to sound as good as it looks. Okay, so I'm starting in the wrong place. Anyway, what I did is I also used plastic polish on the plastic dial plate. But here is the polished up cabinet, and it is It's gorgeous. Basically, it looks about as perfect as you could possibly get. I mean, look at the sheen on it. Real happy with that. So now that it's cleaned, polished, the electronics are done, I'm going to reassemble the tape player and see how it goes. Okay, so now that it's been sitting out in the sun for most of the day, it's time to see if that belt's going to hold. Yeah, that seems to be pretty happy. Looks like the cat span is doing a good job of rotating. Looks like our eye tube is good. Oh shit! What in the hell's that? Something is burning. What was that? Plot thickens. What was that? Could it be like I got a bunch of oil and shit all over this? I did get a lot of crap on the contacts. Don't know. Maybe I burned it up. Well, we have a shorted electrolytic capacitor here. I'm surprised. Usually these tape players weren't used that much, so the electrolytics don't have a lot of use on them, but I think this guy right here, it's a 70 microfarad, strange value, is out. Let's see, it says 70 microfarads, 80 volts, pole, M, gauche. I don't know what that means. I need to look that up. Hopefully it doesn't mean that it's a non-polarized capacitor. Okay, that word, which I'm probably saying wrong, gauche, means essentially container, or it's basically the can in aluminum. So that's what that means, is like negative is the can, which makes sense. So I wanted to make sure that I wasn't translating that wrong. I wonder if this electrolytic's fucked up as well. What does this go to? It does indeed. Let's see. What is it? 50 plus, it's 50 microfarads plus 8 microfarads. And square half moon red. Okay, square. That little stamp thing is the red guy. So while I'm in it, I'll replace those guys too. Whatever. I figured I'd have to do as much. Okay, so I replaced all of those electrolytics. And also I smoked that resistor. Let's try it again. Okay, we've got motors spinning, tubes lighting, and the belt's doing its thing. And there's no smoke, which is obviously much better. Now, I can't really test it right now because I don't have everything hooked up in the cabinet, such as the amplifier and all that. But I can confirm mechanically if it works. I need to go in and see if I actually have any reel-to-reel tapes. If not, I'll just get some tomorrow, but I think it's gonna work. So I just noticed something. I was wondering, my motor was kind of acting funny. One of the screws in here is vibrated out somehow, along with all of these ground contacts. So I need to find another screw, and that'll probably improve its performance dramatically. That's like 10,000% better. Everything seems to be running really smoothly. Let's see how much friction we've got here. Ooh, good friction. That's like not wanting to slow down whatsoever. So now I need to put the other, whatever you call it, that thing back on. Then I'll put the cover on, and whenever I get it back into the case, I'll see if the tape actually pulls and plays. Okay, so we got everything assembled here. Seems like it's actually behaving kind of the way I want it. It's making a little bit of buzzing noise because it's sitting on my bench versus being suspended in the cabinet. But everything seems to be pretty happy. Again, I think I got lucky this time. The The deck isn't warped like most of these guys are, so I'm going to put the, well, actually, I'm not going to put the cover back on because I need to get it back in the cabinet. All right, welcome back to day, I don't recall what day it is now that I've been working on this, but yesterday I was trying to free everything up, get everything working again, and I was almost there, and what I was doing a final little bit of cleanup with some brake cleaner, and accidentally soaked my replacement belt with the stuff, which promptly dissolved the super glue, and it came off. And I was like, I'm tired. I've been working on this thing all day. So I was like, I'm throwing the towel. Re-glued it, let it sit overnight, and so I'm going to reattach it. I actually went and got some random reel-to-reel tape. Del Courtney edited 11/11/1945 Rose Room. I don't know, I just grabbed the first thing. All I care is just a demo that the tape will actually pull and rewind and play and all that good stuff. I won't know until I get this all back together again. And then we can try it out, and if it works, great. If not, I'm just gonna have to let it be. I've done about as much as I wanna do to it. It's been fully recapped, and I've gotten everything to free up as much as I can. Well, that speaker's hosed, no doubt about it. And so what I did is I measured the two pins that are going to the field magnet. And it's measuring like 3.7K. I'll double confirm in the schematic. I mean, it's not crazy for it to be that high. I'm usually expecting more like 900 to 1,000K, but not 3,000K. It's odd. So I'll double confirm that. I don't have any of those resistors at that value here. I'll have to go over to the museum. But I think I'm going to have to definitely take this over, size it up, get the right resistor. Probably it's going to be like a 3700 ohm resistor, probably 10 watts heat dissipation rating. Welcome back to day 5 or 6. I can't keep up with the days anymore, but anyway, so yesterday I had this sort of defeatist attitude, which is, well, the belt's broken, I don't know where to get one. I had this idea. I remember going to the hardware store years ago to get some plumbing parts, and I remember they had a collection of giant O-rings. So I found a variety, and I think that one will work just fine. And this is, I can't remember the name of this, it's polyethylene or propylene or something like that. It's much more durable than the belt that came with it, so it should last longer. And I was trying to think, how do I get this apart to get to that belt? And I think the answer lies in here. I think you remove these two screws, and this assembly comes out in one piece. The other thing is that I decided to see if I could find a owner's manual or schematic for this. I did, and luckily the schematic also showed an exploded diagram of these two reels, and I had put this one back together incorrectly, so I have a diagram so I can take it apart. There's a bunch of little felt friction pieces in there, and I have them incorrectly stacked, and I think what that's for is to keep the tape from essentially bunching up. You know, you want to have just a little bit of friction, and I think that's what that's for. At least that's my guess. You tape player guys can tell me I'm right or wrong. I don't know. But I'm hoping I can get this thing working. That'd be fantastic. Well, look at that. That's probably a lot better than my super glued belt. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to rebuild this. Again, I'm not sure what the terminology is for these parts are, but this needs to be put back together properly with all these little felt pieces. So I'm going to look at my diagram and put it back together correctly. Okay, so here's all these little felt pieces, and it sits on top of this little dude here. I'm sure the tape player people are absolutely having conniptions right now. And you see there's like these little kind of like clutch dealios here. There's that one and this one. This felt piece fits in these little slots like that.
And then we have another one like so. And I think these are supposed to line up. And then there's this last one right here. And again, it needs to kind of line up with these little indentations there. Make sure that's all. I really need to get a better camera situation. I'm sure this is not fun for you guys to watch. Then you need to make sure that these little fingers here line up. Those fingers are there. And that looks like that fits together just fine. Okay, well, test number one, it seems to be pulling tape. Now I'm not sure what playback I've got this on. I need to read the instructions. I think the instructions are in German, but it's playing at a much lower speed. But I'm not sure how to control the speeds on this. Playback 3 and 4. That's supposedly a 60-minute tape. That tape is also not in great shape. I have to admit, this is a kind of nippy day out here, so I'm not sure if maybe the motor's just not warmed up yet, or maybe I need to lubricate it some more. Let me see if rewind works. Actually, I want to see if I can fast forward. Can't do this one hand. Stop. All right. Okay, good. The tape is not bunching up like it was. It seems like rewind is not super happy either. Again, I'm not sure this is going to behave in a warm house versus my cold garage. The fact that it even plays at all is kind of a good thing. I think what I'm going to do is just let this thing run for a while and just hope that whatever is gunked up in there is going to eventually work itself loose. It's probably not helping that I'm sitting the thing on the motor. Maybe what I could do is rewind the tape and see, when I take this top off, how is it actually moving. Especially want to see what's going on with rewind. Why is that? Whoa, stop! Okay, that could have been a mess. Actually, I noticed there's several selections on this guy here. 1, 2, and 3. Let me see what that does. Okay, well, clearly I wasn't paying enough attention. This indeed adjusts the speed. It's basically like a record player. That is obviously faster speed, because you see you've got the little friction wheel going down there and touching the idler, well, the motor. There's another one there. That's probably the slowest speed. Obviously, that wheel right there is doing most of the work, so I think I'm going to do is get in some rubbing alcohol and some sandpaper. I want to make sure that all these surfaces are good and roughed up. Okay, well, that was the trick. What I did is I went in and I cleaned everything up. I made sure that all of the rubber surfaces and all the little friction wheels and whatnot and the belts are all nice and free of grease and oil. I used a little bit of alcohol and just a tad bit of carburetor cleaner to make sure it's completely free. Now it seems to be playing at the correct speed. Well, this is the speed that I would usually expect tapes to play. Turn it off. Go to speed number 2. And you can see it's just a little bit slower. And then the first setting, of course, would be even slower still. And I'm not sure if reverse is going to work or rewind is going to work as well as I want it to. Let me see. Oops. Rewind. It's still not really... It's a little better. I might have to work on that just a little bit more. I won't rewind to really grab. But at least it plays. Let's see. I guess obviously the iTube's not going to work unless I'm actually recording something. Okay, well, these two surfaces here were the problem areas. Is this friction wheel and this reel. And I think there's just a little bit of oil on it. And so now, when I press rewind, it really grabs onto it. I can't even slow it down now with my fingers. So I think that should work. Let me put the cover back on and do another test. All right, well, after many trials and trepidations, I think I've got it to actually work pretty well. Granted, I won't know if the heads are any good until I actually have it hooked up to an audio source, but mechanically, it seems to be working all right now. Granted, rewind is not as fast as I want it to be. Fast forward is fine. It's reverse. Rewind, it's not as great. Like, it kind of starts off slow, but then once it gets going, it's kind of okay. And stop. And the tape's not bunching up. That's what we want. Play. And it seems like it's pretty happy. I want to find out why that motor's making so much noise. I'm not sure if it's because it's sitting on my workbench. Yeah, it was sitting on some foam pieces in the cabinet, so I'm thinking that might dampen down some of that motor buzzing. Even though, you know, once you got the music going, it's not anyone's really going to hear that. And it's going to be inside the cabinet. So I'm probably just being obsessive compulsive about it. And again, let's rewind the tape. And again, it's getting a little bit slow to start. But then we want to get that momentum going. I mean, I don't want it to go crazy fast anyway, because that tape's going to come flying off of there. Come on now. You can do it! Oh! Alright, so I think the tape player is as about as good a shape as I think I'm going to be able to get it with my skills, which are very poor, but it seems to be doing sort of what I want it to do. That's much better than what it was yesterday when I was like, so what? I'll never fix it. Who cares? Oh, welcome back to day number 6 or 7 of working on the large Grundig console, and replacement speakers arrived. Goldwood Sound Incorporated, Chatsworth, California. I've put 10-inch speakers in these guys before. I know they'll fit just perfectly. But in order to do that and make it easier on myself, what I'm going to do is lay this guy on its front, which means I'm going to remove all this stuff and get some towels so I don't do any, you know, cause any scratches or damage. Actually, last night I spent more time polishing this because I want it to be, you know, just perfect. And so it's almost like glass now. This is how it would have looked like from the factory. I know that glossy is not super popular right now, but this is how they came. So I want it to look original. And so let's get to it. Let's put this thing on its front. Hopefully I won't kill myself doing it because my wife is not here to help me. And get to replacing these crappy old speakers. Okay, so we have speakers installed. Nice and tight. Soldered in place. So now I'm going to set this guy upright again and start installing the guts. Actually, I've got one more thing I need to do before I do that, which is add the adapter to the input so that we can run a Bluetooth through it if the future owner so chooses. There's something I forgot, which is this spring here, which is supposed to help ease the door open for the cabinet here, or the radio, is the cord on it's too slack. So I'm going to need to tighten it up a little bit. I need to loosen this guy and yank the cord a little bit more taut so it's not going to fall off like that. All right, so that works a lot better. This makes it ease open just a little bit easier. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to curve that in just a little bit, make sure it doesn't fall off of there. But what I want to do before I do anything, first of all, is add that audio input, and then I want to clean the dust out of here. I know no one's going to see it, but I'll see it, and I care about that, so it's just something I do. All right, so we're going to install the tape input, or the audio input, through the tape player input. This one's basic. You've got only three prongs versus the five or six that I see in some of these. And so it's easy to figure out. You've got red and white for right and left channel, and then this lead here is the negative, or the ground. So I'm going to run this cable through here and zip tie it to the chassis so no one can yank it out of there. Make sure it's not going to hit anything sharp. It'll come out the back anyway. And then I believe, oh yeah, what I need to do is make sure and replace the defective tubes that I got. I've already replaced this guy with a new EM, I think it's an EM34, so that's replaced as well. Pilot lights are both good. Don't need to work on those. And so let's get this going. I'll put this audio input feature on, and then I believe it'll be time to start doing some final touches before reassembly. Well, my absolute worst nightmare has come true, which is I got everything hooked up inside, thinking, well, probably good to go. Let's give it a test fire. And I turned it on and nothing. As in, like, it's completely dead. There's no life. The amplifier and tuner and the lights and the auxiliary power, there's nothing. So there's probably an internal break somewhere. It's probably in the line cord or in one of the places that the line cord connects or one of the main power mains getting to the switch. I might have knocked something loose. A wire could have broken. I don't know. It's not easy to diagnose this stuff when it's this difficult to service. I think what I might do, just because it might make my life a little bit easier, is I'm going to loosen the screws that keep this hinge that holds the tuner in from basically going fully forward. And that way what I can do is leave the amp in here and have a way to check the thing out and easily be able to plug it back in to see what's going on. I get a feeling it's a simple problem. It's something that happened while I was working on it, because it had power before. But at this point, I don't know what that is. I'll just have to do some diagnostics. And I think I'm done for the night. My wife just came in from Los Angeles, so I need to visit with her. Spend some quality husband time. So we'll finish this, work on this tomorrow, basically. Welcome back to the next day, working on the large Grundig stereo. And I'm pretty disappointed in myself, honestly. I guess I got a little cocky, and I fully expected just to turn this thing on, and it was going to work beautifully. And end of episode, in the can, but not so fast. Basically, I have no power. Now, I thought about it last night, and the amplifier chassis and power chassis and the tuner are two individual chassis. And so the first thing I'm going to do is make sure that the problem isn't in the power and amplifier chassis. Luckily, you can plug it in individually without it being plugged into the tuner. And I'll find out real soon, because that transformer is what essentially provides all the juice to the tuner. So if this works, then I can count that out. And the problem is probably a wiring problem between here with the incoming power and to the power switch. So it could be there's a problem. There could be a short in this cord. There could be a disconnected wire going to the switch somewhere, a broken wire, because there's a lot of cabling here. And taking it in and out of the case and moving it around a bunch, something could have bent and broken. It's not out of the question. It's happened to me before. So I'm going to go ahead and plug this in and make sure that the amplifier is happy. Well, nothing's happening in the chassis at all. This guy is dead, which would go on to explain why the tuner chassis is not getting everything. So I don't think it's probably not a wiring error up here. I said error. I think it's a wiring error in the tuner chassis. And luckily, I didn't even bolt it down or anything, so I can take it out and start investigating on the bench. Okay, so I'm going to do some basic diagnostics. We had no tube filament, so the first thing I'm going to check is the tube filament string, which is bound to be those super thick, heavy-duty wires. And they're definitely not open. They are fine. So that makes me wonder about the wiring from this fuse up here. Let's see. I'm not sure. What does that video look like? Oh, okay. I'm not the best at filming this stuff. I know. Check the fuse, make sure it's okay. The fuse is fine. Let me take a look at the contacts for the fuse. Maybe it's just dirty. See, there's these three wires going down into the chassis. It's probably not making for the best video. That guy and that contact. Well, I'm going to stop filming. I'm doing some investigation with the wiring. I want to see what's going on here. Well, I guess there's a first time for anything, but basically the fuse holder was kind of a little bit gunked up. And so I tried it again, and I started getting filament again on these tubes. I didn't bring it up that much because you shouldn't run a tube-powered amplifier without the speakers. You can damage the output transformers. So what I'm going to do is take it over to the cabinet again and see what I get this time. All right, moment of truth again. Either it's going to fail spectacularly and it'll be like Chevy Chase and I'll start kicking plastic blow-molded animals, or it'll work. And nothing. I don't see any lights or anything. Let's see. Interesting. Nothing. Well, I'm not exactly into kicking blow molded animals. I did put a much smaller fuse in there, so I wonder if I blew that. Let's see. No, I didn't blow it. Obviously, we still have a problem here. Let me try plugging it up directly, this amp directly. Obviously, I'm clearly not out of the woods yet. Well, the amplifier just blew the rectifier, which is a good old-fashioned selenium rectifier up here. It promptly blew up, and then actually it took out the fuse as well, so the transformer is ice cold, so no damage was done there. That's very good, because then I would probably be crying right now. But that's a shame. Actually, I can see exactly. This is horribly embarrassing. So I installed one of these electrolytics in backwards. I guess somehow I wasn't paying attention. That's horrible. Off to electronics jail for me. That's probably what took out the rectifier. So I'll need to replace both of these guys. Ugh, how embarrassing and aggravating. Okay, so now we have fixed my errors with the electrolytic capacitors and installed a nice new modern silicone diode bridge.
And so what I'm going to do is take it over and bring my Variac slash isolation transformer. It's fused as well. This, of course, will have a fuse in it. We can bring it up, make sure it's going to be happy. And then we can see what we can do about getting the tuner chassis to light up. Okay, so let's try this out again. I'm going to put this on the lowest amp setting. Give it maybe just a little bit, about 40%. It's not really drawing much at all. I am starting to see some filaments. Okay. Volts, 70%. Well, 70 volts. I'm drawing 3/4 of an amp. That's not bad at all. At 80 volts. Everything looks happy. All the way up. Drawing a little bit of an amp and a quarter. Nothing's making any funny noises. It's interesting, I don't hear anything coming out of the speakers. And I feel like I should, maybe. Again, and there's no input going to this at all. I think we're probably okay. Now, I just noticed something. That guy is on. Okay, well, let's properly hook it up, because right now, let's see. Okay, let's try this again. No. So, clearly, the problem is in the wiring going to the tuner, because I can hook it up this way, and it provides power to the tuner. Let me see if I can get any sound out of it. Just what you can do, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day, 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 day. Well, it's kind of working, but I'm missing a channel here. Don't know what that's about. Well, anyway, it's a start. Well, I've got a dead channel. Left side is not working. So I think it's time to start. I'm going to take that amp out again. And I suspect what I did is I pulled the 12AX7s, and this side is having the problem. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull it out and check the rail on that side and see what's out. I'm probably got a resistor. I'm suspecting there's a resistor that's open or way south or something. It's a good thing it's easier to
God, it's freaking cold. It's having freaky weather. Southern California got snow. That's never happened. I've lived here for 22 years, and it's cold here. My hands are freezing. Well, I found the culprit, and I was suspicious about it because this style of resistor, these little wire-wound guys, and the fact that it's got corrosion on the ends means that probably one end of the wire is corroded, and this is an open resistor. It's a 100-ohm resistor. It's coming directly off the 12AX7, going directly into the output section. And so we need to replace that dude. I bet that's probably the problem. Well, I don't have any more 100-ohm resistors except for this huge guy here. And when I measured this guy, it's way off. And so just basically to test to see if this fixes the problem, I just temporarily soldered that in. I think tomorrow I'm going to go get some new resistors. Probably replace all of those wire wounds. But I just want to see if this fixes that channel. Okay, so we've restored right and left channel. So that's probably all I'm going to do for today. I might pull the tuner chassis out because I've still got a problem with the switch basically not being able to control the unit. Anyway, to start. Okay, I decided to grit and bear it and get the tuner chassis back out, which I did, and decided to dig into what might be causing my power-up issue on this guy. And the problem is the switch. I did a continuity test on it, and it's not turning on. So usually what that boils down to is there's probably some gunked up material inside the switch, and you can usually just soak kind of the I'm going to turn it upside down, or turn it right side up, but I'm going to get a bunch of WD-40 and use a soldering iron to heat up the metal parts, so maybe that'll help free things up a little bit. Actually, I just noticed something that is sinister. I thought that was a crack. There's like a little piece there. I think I'm going to soak the crap out of this thing and hope it'll work itself loose. All right, well, luckily I was able to free it up. So now, let's turn it on. Get continuity, turn it off. It's off, on. Good. So we solved that problem. The other thing that I have to admit is that radio's not working that great in this thing at all. And there's a few things I see that I'm going to check right away. Number one is going to be this big guy here. This is another one of those resistors that tends to go south real quick. I'm just going to have to do some basic checks here in the circuit. It's difficult because it's not exactly easy to hook this thing up to get voltages so I can measure things. I'd have to jerry-rig something up. But I'm just going to do some random checks here with some of these resistors. FM was essentially dead. I'm going to retest the ECC 85 tube because I put one in it that came from our stash and I assumed it was good. You know what they say about assuming things. It makes that ass out of you and me. Anyway, my wife taught me that little ditty. I thought it was funny. All right, welcome back today, whatever, of working on the large Grundig stereo, and we still have some problems. Number one, AM works okay, marginal, I'd say. FM is not working, just getting static, and the bass response in the speakers is not what I want. So we're going to increase that bass by making a little, I did call it, but basically it's a bass boosting circuit. I looked at a few online and I like this one the best. I can't draw worth a damn anymore. But what we're going to do is we're going to have two inductors. And in between those inductors is going to be a low voltage 220 microfarad electrolytic capacitor. And it's going to look exactly like this. Going to the speaker.
And what I'm going to do is get these individual components and solder them to these guys. I'm going to go downstairs and get a speaker and compare what it sounds like with and without this to make sure this actually works. And then I've brought both of the chassis here. I have a plethora of available parts here, so I want to make sure and check everything out on both of these. This amplifier, I want to make sure that the resistors are in spec up and down the rails so that we have nice balanced channels, because right now there's a bunch of like weird iffy resistors, especially the two that I was looking at last night. I'm going to recheck my tubes. We actually have some better quality tube testers here that are more calibrated than mine, especially checking the ECC83 tube. Also, I'm going to test the ECH81 tube. I believe that one is most responsible for the front end of the IF strip. Then again, I'm not a mechanical genius. I'm not an electronic genius, so I could be completely blowing smoke out of my rear end. So let's get started. Let me go downstairs and get a speaker. I'll have an amplifier source to run it through, and then we can try it out. Okay, so that was a useless project.
So much bass. Can I stand it? Listen to that boom. Boom.
This didn't do that much at all. So what I did is I started replacing all the faulty resistors in this guy. It is sounding a lot better. Also, my tone controls were all gunked up, so I've been using deoxit to clean those up. And now I'm testing the tubes again, and the EC85 tube, which is responsible for FM, is questionable. It's not a happy tube at all. I'm going to check the other section, but it needs to be replaced probably. That might explain our FM problems. I always assume that the tubes that are downstairs in this building are good, but not always. Okay, so I replaced two of the tubes, and then I was looking underneath here, and we have this resistor probably burnt open, so I need to pull up the schematic and see what that is. That's going to EF89, pin number one. All right, I feel like a total idiot. What I did was I misread the print on one of the tubes. It's supposed to be EBF89. I put in an EF89, which is a completely different pinout. That was screwing up my radio reception completely. So I put the right tube in there, and now it seems to work pretty well now on FM. That's not the radio. That's the record player in the other room playing. What's the matter? All right, make a liar out of me. There we go.
I'm gonna give you a heads up. I will be interrupting music, talking over music. The music won't stop, nor will I. So, my goal for the next 2 hours is to raise $3,000.
Okay, welcome back to day whatever of working on the Grundig console, and as usual, when I take stuff over to the museum, there's all kinds of things happening. It's very disruptive. But to kind of go over what happened yesterday, I hooked everything up at the museum and hooked it up to a pair of speakers so I could really diagnose what was going on. What was happening is that I misread the schematic. I thought there were two EF89 tubes in here. It turned out there are not. There is one. And then there's an EBF89. So I had the wrong tube and the wrong socket, because what was happening is my grid was measuring way over. It was supposed to only measure about 40 or 50 volts. Instead, it was measuring 250 with the tube inserted. With the tube out, it measured correctly. So I spent probably half the day trying to figure out what was going on before I glanced at the schematic and saw. It's because I assumed, my mind was telling me that's an EF89, in reality it was an EBF89. I also put a good I-tube in it. I also replaced all the out-of-spec resistors in the amplifier. So now it's time to start doing some major reassembling. I also cleaned all the controls again because they were kind of sticky. The last thing I'm going to do is make sure the tuning mech is all nice and oiled, because it still seems like it's not as fine moving as I want. I want this to be perfect. And then we're going to start putting it back in the cabinet.
And then I want to do some testing. I need to put the record player back in, the tape player back in, see how it sounds. I am toying with the idea of doing something drastically different, which is, if the bass is not where I want it, I'm tempted to buy a powered subwoofer to put in the middle of the inside of the cabinet facing backwards towards the wall to go with the other speakers to fill out the sound. I thought I had a powered subwoofer up in my crawl space in my attic, but I must have gotten rid of it and I forgot about it. And so I'll have to make do with what I've got now, but I will try to make sure that this thing sounds as amazing as it looks, which means maybe a little bit of controversy. I think what it is that the speakers that came with it were finally tuned and engineered to work with this amplifier. And so I'm using modern subwoofers. They're not as tuned to the amplifier. Either way, I'll make it work somehow. Okay, I want to show you guys something which is common on these guys. These are clutch plates. And there's one for FM and one for AM. And the grease that they use on this can gunk up, causing them to stick, which can make AM, when you have FM detented, want to tug, because the clutch plate will not be retracting as much as it should. So now you see I'm on the broadcast band. This is tuning really nicely, like butter. Likewise, the FM, you want to have this kind of like weighted response. Just feels nicer. You also want to make sure and lubricate all of your bearing surfaces and the tuning mechanism. So we got one here. We got one here. We have one back here. And then we also have one for FM. Just want to work it in real well until it spins really nicely. All right, the last thing I want to do is cinch this I-tube up. This brass piece should be around the plastic, and it's around the glass. So that'll get the tuning eye up close, right up next to the glass. And it's going to be time to do some reassembling. All right, we're starting to get there. It is now mostly reassembled. This thing is killing my back. Anyway, got all the guts installed. Both chassis are in, tape player is in, record player is in, and we have the Bluetooth running through the tape side right now. What is that? Oh, dust mite. Now, let's try out the tape player. Something's funny about the tape player. I think this tape must have been recorded at some weird speed. Sounds a little slow, but I'm not sure what speed that was recorded at originally. And the record player has a problem too. Several problems, actually. Let's turn this down. Let's see. Let me see if I can get vocals on this. Well, I think what it is, there's two problems. Number one, it's cold out here. And the motor, even though I lubricated it, I think it needs to be lubricated some more, because it's taking a little while to get going. It was really slow, then it gradually sped up. The other thing is that the cartridge, there must be a wiring error in the cartridge or something, because it's only picking up on one channel. It's only picking up on the right side. Just a bit afraid. She took her to selling and she got her a man. He never knew what hit him, and I guess he'll never understand.
we know that both channels are working, so it's not an amp problem. It's definitely in the record player. There is one thing I did notice, however, which was prior to me working on it, someone had let this cable here, which is for the record player, sit on top of one of the tubes and it melted the wire. And I'm not sure if that meant that the wire is fused inside or what. But we have a channel out, and I'm thinking it's probably in the cartridge. The cartridge is kind of funny. So basically the record player's got to come back out, and we need to do some work on it. Now, worst comes down to worst, our museum has a record player guy who is admittedly, and I will gladly admit it, he's way better at working on these record players than I am. And again, I'm not really sure what's going on with the tape recorder. I'm thinking it's probably more of how it was recorded. It's probably recorded at a slower speed on a commercial machine. Just sounds slow. Then again, I don't know what this recording is. I need to find something that has some sort of recording that I'm familiar with, like Frank Sinatra or something, because I have no clue if that's playing at the right speed or not, but it just sounds slow. All right, so I got the record player out, and when I attempted to remove the needle that was on it, it just busted off. Luckily, this thing come with a bunch of new old stock needles, and it has an extra one of these. And I can see it's got these contacts. It looks like it just pops in. If these contacts are dirty, I can totally see that being a problem. And I've also got some new needles, new old stock needles that the previous owner had. So I've got a lot of opportunities to make some improvements here. And I'm also going to try re-lubricating the motor. And I warmed up the garage a little bit. I got my heater going. We're having unusually cold weather in California these days. And so I'm not used to it. I'm a big freaking weenie when it comes to this weather. So let's see if I can pop this guy out of here and see if I can clean the contacts and also put a new needle on it. Okay, so I re-lubricated the bearings on both the platter as well as the motor. The other thing I did is I realized that I accidentally had one of the washers that was supposed to go on top of the roller bearings underneath the platter on top. So that wasn't right. Another mistake. I've made so many mistakes on this stereo. So now I have our nice new cartridge and needle. The contact's been clean. We can put that back into the head unit here, or the tone arm. And then we'll put this back into the cabinet, and before I button it all up, I'll try a record again, make sure that it's playing at the right speed, and we've got both right and left channels. Well, I still have a channel out, and unfortunately, I'm about to, I don't know, have conniptions. It is a problem inside of the tuner chassis, because, I'm not sure if you can hear that. Let me turn the volume up. Definitely that's the left channel. Here's the right channel. Nothing happens. So, a wiring problem. A problem. I swear, the next time I see one of these things that shows up, I might have second thoughts about working on it. This has been the most problematic thing I've worked on in years. Okay, well, I've been going through checking the continuity of all the leads that were coming through this connection and all the way down here to the phono switch, which is this one right here. And this one is the right and left channels. They both checked. They have continuity. So then I traced it all the way. I traced some of these connections over to this switch, which is the stereo switch. And what I found was happening, I'm not sure, it's the stereo switch. And what was happening is this was still binding about partially through the switch, like it wasn't moving. And so I freed it up. That's the only thing I can figure, because everything else like has continuity. And of course it's hard to tell if that's really the case, because I'd have to take the amplifier out and once again wire everything in manually. But I think what I'm going to do is take this over and see if I can put a little bench next to it and the amplifier and cook up the record player and see if I can somehow tickle the connections until I find something. Or maybe this binding switch, maybe that was the problem. I'll hook it up and see what happens. I'm not holding out any hope, though. Okay, so I found the problem. I had to jerry-rig cook this crap all together so I could actually do some troubleshooting. I'm not sure if this is showing up in the camera, but there's a little loop of hard wire used to kind of like bunch this wire up. And because I'd set it on the counter, this wire had leaned over and touched. God, I can't, this is hard to film. This little contact here, so it's shorting out the channel. So now I have like both right and left channels. So, and the record player seems to be also, oh shit, I'm burning up my wire here. All right, I gotta turn this off. But now comes the painful process of once again putting it back in the cabinet. It's like the fifth or sixth time I've had to do this with this thing, so, but I'm hoping this is the last. I say that, I'm not going to hope anything. I'm going to assume something else is going to go wrong. But we're getting there. Slowly but surely, we're getting there. It's a kind of a dreary, cold, wet day, and my wife has got a cold. Luckily, it's not COVID, so I'm out here in the garage. Jesus. Like I said, if anyone asks me to do one of these, I'll have to twist my arm and pay me $1 million to do it. I'm still working the bugs out. It's mostly done. But, I'm still not super happy with the bass. I think it could be more. Probably take care of that tomorrow. I keep on cleaning the crap out of this pot. There's a little bit of a low spot right there. Seems like a lot of the tone controls are working pretty well now. And FM radio is working really well now. I've also been letting the phono motor run. Feels like the longer I let it run, the more the new oil and grease works into the bearings. I do need to put some new felt here. I feel like when you turn up the bass, this little connection here like rattles a little bit. I think if there was more squishy, newer felt there, that wouldn't do that as much. But I'm being nitpicky. I feel like I am wore out from working on this today. This is going to be a ridiculous episode. And I'm sure that if you are still watching this episode at this point, thank you. It's been a kind of a ridiculous, dragging out sort of project this time around for sure. All right, welcome back
to the next day of working on the Grundig stereo. And as mentioned yesterday, I wasn't really happy with the amount of bass that I was getting. And so I found this over at the museum. It was donated recently. It's a powered bass speaker. And all you have to do is run an audio input through it. Meaning basically I'll run the incoming signal to the amplifier, run a separate line of that signal to this. It is just skinny enough to fit down in the bottom of the cabinet. I'm going to put a piece of foam underneath it so it doesn't rattle around, and that'll give me the deep bass that I feel the set is missing, and will give us our nice full audio range that I think the owner of this will really appreciate, future owner. And so let's get going. What I need to do is take the amp out again and run a separate wire that goes underneath and to the speaker. We can do that one of several different ways. We can either run a little line in via this, or we can have some RCA cables. I think I'm gonna use RCA cable because I have some shielded cables. And then obviously we'll need to have this have its own power source, which should be easy. We will use the same power source as being used by the tape player. And that way this will turn on and off with the stereo, which is, we don't want this to stay on 24/7. That would be stupid. So it needs to be switched. And luckily these little socket areas here are switched, so no big deal. So let's go ahead and take this out and install that line. And before I button things up, because what's going to have to happen is I'm going to have to secure this permanently to the cabinet. And that fiberboard is sufficiently thick. If it were thin, that would be bad. That means this would cause a lot of rattling. Okay, so I've got my audio cables running in. This is going to be the audio in going to the bass speaker in the bottom of the cabinet. So let's go over and do a dry run before we bolt everything up and make sure this is actually going to work. All right, that makes a huge difference. See, the idea is that, you see how I've got this sitting around back and it's facing outwards? Well, that's going to be inside of the cabinet. And what that's going to do is further provide a little more bass response by the fact that this cabinet is going to resonate, and it's going to resonate that wood. And I'll have the speaker pushing out the back so it will bounce off of the wall. At least that's my theory. I'm not an audio technician, but this seems like this is going to work great. So I just need to do a few other things. Namely, I want to put some foam down. So this, actually, you know what I do? I want to do, I want to put this in there first to see if I actually need to do that. Maybe it won't rattle. Well, that sounds just fine and dandy. All right, well, I'm pretty happy with that. I think I've been doing a little fine-tuning with making sure it's not too much bass. I want it to sound just about right. I am going to tell the future owner of this thing, hey, there is an adjustment you can make. And so I'll show them how to do it. They're all right here. So if someone wants to do some fine-tuning, they can. I just realized something. Getting this in here is going to be real fun because, man, I've got all the equipment now in the stereo, and I need to tip it over. The other option is to have it hanging. Oh, man, this is frustrating. What do I do? Can't get a drill underneath there. My wife is sick. And getting this thing over on its front without me killing myself is going to be all kinds of fun. All right, folks. Well, stereo is pretty much done. Got the tape player going. Got the record player spinning. Got the Bluetooth running. Radio works fine. Unfortunately, I found that all of the reel-to-reel, most of the reel-to-reel tapes we have over at our museum are recorded at a different speed that the tape player here won't play back. Instead, it's going to... I had a music tape that I tried to play, and the stupid tape, whatever this is, Ian and Sylvia, would break as soon as I pushed play. The tape is deteriorated. So the only tapes that I'm able to play are studio tapes, and so they're at a different speed.
January 28th, Marshall was busy at work when he noticed glittering objects in the riverbed. He took about 3 ounces of them to his employer at New Helvetia.
Yeah, Sutter's Mill, California history. Here's the record player. Likewise, we can put the Bluetooth back on and press. So I think what I'm going to do is let this thing play for the remainder of the week here, because I want to make sure that everything is going to work nicely. Let's rewind this guy. Oh, come on. It is cold in my garage right now, and so everything is being a little bit like an old man. But anyway, it seems like everything is working okay. I'm going to have our record player guy do a double check on the record player, make sure we're okay. I'll have the tape player guy look at the tape reel-to-reel, make sure that we're okay on that. I'm pretty confident the rest of the electronics are just totally fine. I was listening to this last night, and it does sound pretty good, so I'm pretty happy with it. I'm going to, like I said, what I want to make sure is that it's going to play reliably. Because whoever gets this thing is going to put it in their living room, who man cave or whatever, and I don't want to have to make a house call and have to figure out a way how to fix this huge thing. Anyway, guys, this is probably the longest episode I've ever made. I made more mistakes, I had more problems, but I learned a lot, and in the end, this is a rather nice piece, and it's always a fascinating joy for me to work on these guys. If you have any questions or comments, you can leave them down below. I'll try to get to them, even though I've been doing a poor job of that lately. And but I appreciate you guys sticking with me and watching, and I hope that you enjoyed watching this episode. And until the next time that something comes across the workbench, I'll see you guys next time. Adios.